The organization known as the Guild has its origins in two major houses.
The shipbuilder family of Castellani and the fisherman family of Nicolotti. These houses were originally meant to protect and support their workers, even if, beyond its facade, they fought against each other. Venice had a great number of guilds. Workers of same categories joined each other to enjoy greater political influence, but at the end of 17th century, poverty and crisis rendered these organizations nothing more than groups of unemployed citizens. In this environment, the Guild of Thieves started to grow in power among Venetian society. Extortion and drug dealing were its major businesses. They soon realized that to keep in the shadows, alliance had to be set. The first and more lucrative was with the brothels. It was extremely convenient knowing when a nobile signore was living in his houses and attended to go have some fun. In exchange, the ladies of the brothels could enjoy the protection of the guild. In the beginning, very few wanted to stain their honor setting an alliance with the thieves. But when social unrest started to grow more and more, many people were forced to accept compromises in order to feed and shelter their loved ones. At the time of the opening of the rent in the sky, the Guild of Thieves could count on the support of no less than 12 loyal workers' unions. Soon, the name of the Guild of Thieves was easily abbreviated in the Guild. Today, many people still seek the protection of the syndicate, offering their services in exchange. Every profession has a role, from the sharp razor edge of the barber, to the clever of the butcher, to the dog handler, whose hounds are so useful to chase fugitives. Talents long forgotten by the ruling classes now finding new life in the guild. In the very end, they are the poor, the common citizens, but well-directed and trained by the spreading web of recruiters. These are able to coordinate dozens of citizens to a single goal with minimal effort. Omertà, fedeltà, and fraternità are the three golden rules on which the complex guild's hierarchy has its pillars. At its top, it sits the King of Thieves, a mysterious person whose identity is secret even to his closest associated. Directly below the king, there are five princes of thieves, one for each remaining sestriere of the city. Their identities are known to very few, and each one of them is specialized in a particular crime area, such as prostitution, smuggling, robbery, and so on. Every prince receives reports from various capodecina, their loyal right-hand man along the streets. Skilled acrobats able to swiftly move on rooftops to strike their victims from above. The word of the King of Thieves is law and is strictly enforced by his counselor and thugs, the Baroni. House of Virtue is the first and longest ally of the guild. It's composed of harlots who live in the brothels, once desperate sex workers, now organizing a full-fledged union led by the Council of the Madames. Lady Magdalene is the head of the council, a position democratically chosen and in control of all of the city's brothels. The power of this organization has risen so much through the years to start grow fear in the King of Thieves himself, eyes and ears of skilled charmers able to penetrate the heart of their victims in the most vulnerable moments. The stiletto is their weapon of their choice, sharp and easy enough to hide. Other perfectly recognizable figures roaming streets of Venice are the Pulcinellas. Crazy, pompous drunkard wearing tall hats and white costumes, always looking for alcohol, a fight, or both, even at the same time. The mask of Pulcinella made his first appearance during the Carnevale as a depiction of a fool, silly, unruly character. These made that mask perfectly suitable for anybody who wanted to perform unrestrained acts of violence. They proclaimed themselves as the great and noble cult of the end of the days. Their origin isn't known, but what is known for sure is the connection to the madness coming from the rent in the sky, that brings people to live the rest of their days in this dissolute lifestyle. Drink, fight, gamble, brawl are the things that cult can do the best. Without a hierarchy, the crown of the leader passes from hand to hand to the person found worthy through the greatest successes. This individual is crowned king for a day. That is actually the span of time of this charge. Some Pulcinellas secured the weirdest rides. Ostriches accidentally freed from Venetian docks. Even if the cult isn't very reliable, the guild often uses these lunatics when it is necessary to bring havoc in the campi for just a handful of ducats. Then it comes probably the most important union among the guilds of Venice that stands at the very core of the whole organization, the Guild of Gondoliers. While carrying goods and people among the most important of the city, gondoliers can listen more than anybody else. It is said that if a leaf falls in Santa Croce, the gondolier in Castello will know it before it reaches ground. Among the most recent annexion to the ranks of the guild, we find the Rialto Assassins, former an independent organization that now pledged allegiance to the guild in exchange of a safe pass through the city. Even if nobody can be so insane to break a deal with the guild, these assassins are so skillful that the King of Thieves is well aware to have not the complete control on them. And even if Venice is imbued with magic due to the rent in the sky, this is not the strong point of the guild. That's why black lamps are deployed. The power of the glowing gems was discovered during a famine caused by bacteria found in food. But in a warehouse where these gems were stored, food was intact. It says that these gems are a creation of the doctors. Black lamps are individuals with these tools in their arsenal, fielding in case of extreme need to counter enemy magic. The lamps not only fight magic, but boost morale of their allies too. An even stranger creature is Baba Yaga, which can be summoned only through the most sinister blood rituals. She'll help who she wishes, and there are rumors about how, disguised as an old lady, she made deals with the King of Thieves, unveiling him many secrets of the city and the activities of its most sinister dwellers, like Roshar, Strigoian doctors. Her powers can inflict unimaginable pain to the foe of the guild, while filling the heart of common people with inhuman strength and bravery. But there's a price to pay when Baba Yaga is summoned, and often the prince who requires her services shares the fate of his foes. Baba Yaga is a weird woman, resembling a wrinkled old lady who carries a huge cauldron filled with the blood of enemies and allies alike. She taps on it to cast her spells, and when summoned, her services are bonded to a single person, and even if they only last instants, huge and huge sacrifice have to be performed for each summoning. Tales are told about how vicious her fury can be, or how she drained the blood of who was fool enough to try to control her or asked too many questions. This is only a fraction of the lore about this important first faction in Carnevale. If this intrigued you, you can find many more details about it in the rulebook. Next faction to be covered is the one of the strange ancient creatures known as the Rashar. Subscribe to the channel to receive all the updates.